This tutorial shows you how to calculate and interpret the two-way ANOVA in SPSS. Like other analytical tests, the two-way ANOVA has a few requirements. The essential ones are normal distribution, which I have already shown in detail in the linked video, and homogeneity of variance, which I will show alongside in this video. To calculate the two-way ANOVA, we navigate through the SPSS menu via Analyze, General Linear Model, Univariate. We then define the model by moving the variable to be tested for differences into the dependent variable field. For the fictitious dataset, this is income. Our two factors here, gender, 2 levels, and experience, 4 levels, are entered in the fixed factors box. Note, the factors are typically nominal or categorical, but may also be ordinal. However, it should be noted that too many factor levels can be a hindrance depending on the size of the dataset. Next, we take care of all the settings and start with the model. If both the two factors and their interaction are to be analyzed, nothing needs to be set here. If only the two factors without interaction are to be analyzed, first click on Build Terms and then select them individually or together and move them to the right to Model after selecting the main effects type. If only the interaction term is to be examined, both must be selected. At the same time, with the control key pressed, command on Mac, and after selecting interaction under type, moved to the right to model. As I said, I want to test the interaction and main effects, which is why I can leave everything blank here and leave full factorial model selected. The contrasts button is typically not necessary, unless you have made explicit assumptions in advance that certain factor levels should be tested together for differences to other factor levels after the two-way ANOVA. For example, if you want to combine different intervention groups or, to stay with the example, combine the two high experience levels and compare them with other levels. A so-called profile plot can be requested via the Plots button, which can look like this for example. This helps with interpretation and is also a good addition to the presentation of results for a two-way ANOVA, especially in the case of observable interaction effects. The creation only requires the assignment of the two factors to the horizontal axis or as separate lines. For better readability, it is recommended to use the factor with fewer levels for the lines, for example, gender in my case. Consequently, the factor with more levels is placed on the horizontal axis. Then simply click Add. Further diagrams can be added if necessary. I also recommend ticking Include Error Bars. The post-hoc button can be ignored here. This is relevant for the one-way ANOVA. Of course, we will still calculate post-hoc tests for the two-way ANOVA, but these are requested via the next button, EM means, estimated marginal means. Here you will find all the factors tested in the model. In a two-way ANOVA, typically both factors individually and their interaction. These are all moved to the display means for field and both checkboxes, compare main effects and compare simple main effects, are checked. In addition, Bonferroni is selected when adjusting the confidence interval. The reason for this is that when we compare the different factor levels with each other, multiple comparisons are made with the same groups. This increases the alpha error, wrongly rejecting the null hypothesis, i.e. the erroneous identification of an effect, in some cases considerably. To protect against this, an adjustment or correction is made. Bonferroni is recommended here, this is the most conservative and established method. The Save button allows you to save predicted values by the model as well as residuals, which is typically not necessary. The Options button is important again, where Descriptive Statistics and Estimates of Effect Size should be checked. To test homogeneity of variance, homogeneity tests can be checked, but I will address the limitations of this in a moment. That's it for the settings, and the two-way ANOVA can now be calculated by SPSS. The output is initially very long, but we will focus on the essential things. At the top, we see the observations per factor level for the two factors in the ANOVA. Below this are the descriptive statistics for the factor combinations, giving you a first impression of how the mean values may differ. For my fictitious example, it is already quite clear that income increases for both genders with higher levels of experience, but the gender pay gap also appears to exist. Let's move on to the promised test for homogeneity of variance. Homogeneity of variance means that the variances of the test variable are approximately the same across the groups. Groups mean the respective factor combinations. For example, male experience level 1 is a group, female experience level 3 is also a group, etc. First of all, if these groups are approximately the same size, a test for homogeneity of variance is unnecessary and you can proceed directly. As you can see, a well-planned study is key here already. If the group sizes are unequal, homogeneity of variance should be tested, which is done analytically with the Levene's test. However, the Levene's test is unreliable. With small samples, it is not sensitive enough, and with large samples, it is too sensitive. With large samples, from 30 to 50 observations upwards per group, moderate violations are tolerable anyway, and an eye test is usually sufficient. With standard deviations of approximately the same size, you are generally on the safe side. However, if the Levene's test has to be reported despite all the problems, the null hypothesis of equality of variances should not be rejected, i.e. a larger p-value should exist. The robust calculation based on median should be reported in that case. But again, this test is not reliable. Most reviewers are aware of this and criticize it. If the eye test shows that the variances are clearly unequal, only a non-parametric ANOVA can be calculated, but not an SPSS. Bootstrapping is also an option, but this is not calculated for the two-way ANOVA itself, but rather for the subsequent analyses only. Now let's focus on the main table, tests of between subjects effects. This again has far too many rows. The rows that contain the factors to be tested are essential. In my case, these are gender, experience and gender times experience. Here you can look at the respective p-values in the sig column. If these are sufficiently small, an effect of this factor on income could be observed. Sufficiently small depends on the context and not on an arbitrarily set value such as 0.05, which is explained very well in the article by Wasserstein et al. The requested effect size, the partial error square, is also shown in the last column. Partial because it quantifies the strength of a specific factor's effect on income while accounting for the variance explained by other factors in the model. It represents the proportion of variance uniquely attributable to this factor after controlling for the influence of the remaining predictors. It is calculated by the factors type 3 sum of squares divided by the factors and the errors type 3 sum of squares. In some disciplines, the partial error squared is less important, as detailed analyses are carried out in the follow-up analysis and effect sizes are calculated for those. In this fictitious dataset, the factors gender and experience as well as their interaction could be observed. However, we do not yet know between which factor combinations and levels within factors differences exist. We have only seen initial indications in the descriptive data. The follow-up analysis now depends largely on whether an interaction could be observed in this table or not. The two following videos show the follow-up analyses in the case of an observable or no observable interaction.